va a llegar el gol del Arsenal. Ozil marca. Mesut Ozil.
This is Arsecast Extra.
Hello and welcome to another Arsecast Extra, as always, with James from Gunnerblog. James, good morning to you. Welcome to a new week in this strange new world.
Yeah, it's another week and in a very strange world. I don't really know what to say about it. It's so mad. It's so surreal. It's like, I said on Twitter over the weekend, it's like being in a film, but just none of the sort of films you'd actually want to be in. You know what I mean?
Yeah. What film would you want to be in if you could pick a film life? What would that film be?
Maybe like You've Got Mail. Do you know what I mean? Something happy, easy, a rom-com, basically. Right. I don't want any complications. I don't want any baddies, essentially. What would you be in?
I don't know. I was thinking, like, I mean, if you could pick any film, it would obviously be something that, you know, had things that you couldn't do in real life. So, you know, a space movie or, you know, something where you could fly spaceships and stuff like
True.
That. But there's usually baddies in that.
That's the issue, and I wouldn't cope well with that. I'll tell you what, go back to Fever Pitch and to live that as a grown-up rather than a three-year-old as I was at the time.
Yeah.
I could do with that, being... Being in that film.
You could be in an animated movie as well, because cartoon characters get to do all kinds of stuff. And then, you know, you can have a 50-ton weight dropped on your head and you're splattered and flattened, and then you just kind of pop
True.
Back into life, you know? So
look at Kenny in South Park. He keeps coming back.
Yeah, yeah. I wouldn't want to be Kenny, though.
No.
I don't think so.
It's not top of my wish list.
So have you been watching any movies over the weekend? Doing anything interesting while not being out and about?
I'd love to say yes, I have been doing something interesting, but it's been pretty low-key. I've been doing sort of work and cracking on as normal. I have been pretty much contained within the house, though. Have you?
Yes, for the most part, apart from, you know, some dog walking. There's been, you know, no going out, no doing anything. I don't know if you saw the news from here, but from last night, all bars, restaurants, cafes, you know, public places like that are closed.
It's going to be a strange, somber St. Patrick's Day, isn't it?
It is. I mean, look, I mean, it's so weird. I think maybe a week or 10 days ago, we were sitting here talking on this podcast going, I'd be a bit mad if they didn't close down the parade. And then now you're thinking, imagine if it were going ahead. There's just, you know, no conceivable way something like that could happen. But, you know, yeah, I don't know what to say about it other than it's just, it is bizarre and surreal. And, you know, to sort of stress the responsibility we all have individually and collectively to help not put a stop to this, but certainly slow the spread of it. It was a bit disappointing to see people out and about, you know, doing things as normal, you know, concerts and bars. I mean, here, you know, they were showing pictures of bars in Temple Bar and stag parties with their COVID-19 t-shirts on. Great, great look, chaps, you know. But with all the information, people are still sort of in close quarters with each other. And those people might be fine. It's really the other people that you have to think of.
Yeah, I mean, it's tricky. I don't know. What's the instruction in Ireland? Because in the UK, it still feels like we're sort of the anomaly, really, in how the world is dealing with this globally.
Yeah, it's, I mean, the what they're calling social distancing, you know, this
right.
this idea. I mean, look, we all have to do certain things in order to keep going. So you got to get to the shops and you've got to pick up your prescriptions and things like that. But for the most part, it's like stay at home as much as you possibly can and entertain yourself at home or just sit around, but, you know, minimize the contact with other people. Therefore, you minimize the risk of picking something up or also spreading something as well. So that's really where we are with it. And anecdotally, I was had to visit a hospital yesterday, unfortunately, but the entire place is shut down to visitors. So, you know, right. even if you've got a sick relative in hospital, you are not allowed in to visit them on the ward or anything like that. So, you know, that's how strict the restrictions are. You can understand why in a hospital, but, you know, if a hospital is doing that, it tells you a lot, I think.
Yeah, and listen, I mean, obviously, one caveat we should offer to this whole conversation is that it's a very fast-moving situation. So anything I say about what you can and can't do in the UK at the moment probably won't be true by the time this comes out. But it is weird here because the directions are not as explicit. You know, you're told if you have symptoms, isolate, stay in your house. But apart from that, everyone's kind of permitted to go about their businesses. A lot of workplaces have said, don't come in, work from home. Other workplaces are saying, it's fine or it's up to you. And I think a lot of people who I've spoken to, again, anecdotally, feel a bit uncertain and a bit confused of how best to operate, because I don't think we have massively clear leadership on that front at the moment.
I mean, that's the thing.
So that's tricky. Yeah,
it is. And look, certain jobs allow you to work from home. Many jobs don't. And that's the reality of those situations where people are, you know, people are being asked to do certain things that are just impossible to do, where that might be the best thing to do. I was speaking to my daughter, and she was. Spain is in lockdown. She's in Barcelona, and Spain is basically in a kind of lockdown. And the company that she works for had asked her to, you know, everybody put some pictures on your social media to say, you know, we're at home, we're working from home, et cetera, et cetera. But you're all expected in the office on Monday. It's like,
right?
Yeah. So people and things. You know, that is the difficult part of this, is that, you know, for all the good advice and all the sensible advice and all the direction, people are still going to be people.
Yeah, I mean, another thing that's sort of happened here over the weekend, and I'm sure it's the same in Ireland to an extent, is that because if you contract symptoms, you're not really encouraged to go to the doctor or the hospital or get yourself tested. There's a lot of people I know, people quite close to me, who are ill in some way, shape or form, but without any clarity as to whether or not it's, you know, the bad one sort of thing.
Yeah.
And that's you know, obviously what you do in those circumstances, you take yourself out of the picture, you know, you isolate and regardless. But again, from a sort of psychological perspective, it creates a lot of uncertainty. And that's the pervading feeling at the moment, isn't it? Uncertainty.
It is. I mean, what is the worst sound in the world? People might say Phil Collins. They might say nails scraping down a blackboard. They might say the outrageous chatter of a magpie. But the worst sound in the world right now is somebody coughing. Because you're like, I'm getting away from those. I mean, I've you know, had a problem with this for many years. You know, people who don't cover their mouths when they cough or they sneeze are the worst. They really are. And you know, even in normal circumstances, you're kind of like, ugh. But now you're when you hear somebody cough, you're like, I got to get like to a different county, just to get away from that. It's not paranoia, I guess, but you know, every cough now sounds like a transmittable event or something.
But I would say the only, well, look, there's always a silver lining, isn't there? There is always a positive, and I have to say I have enjoyed the sort of scenes of, you know, communities in Spain or Italy kind of banding together, and whether it's like the DJ on his balcony, he must be pissing off all his neighbours enormously. Do you see that guy?
I did see that one. I mean, look, there was one, wasn't there, of a tenor singing Nessun Dorma, which was amazing. And he's there, and you can imagine sitting in your flat or standing out on your balcony on a warm evening, and there is this man with a majestic voice singing Nessun Dorma. And then the other side of that is some fucking dude with his iPhone plugged into his Dex, and he's playing fucking Scooter or techno or something like that. You're like, oh no.
I know. I keep sort of looking out my window, looking at all my various neighbours, thinking, so when we go into full lockdown, like, who's going to be the opera singer? Who's going to be the DJ? We will see. Will we all be out on our, you know, dancing in our windows or doing aerobics classes or something like that?
Yeah.
I'd say I was woken up this morning at, like, I forget what time, but by a helicopter that was hovering in absolute seriousness directly over my flat. and not very high. I don't know what... I mean, it really lent itself to the sort of weird war zone apocalypse now feeling that there is in London by being woken up by a chopper.
Wow.
Seemingly, I don't know, monitoring my behaviour.
That was looking for you specifically, you think?
I can only assume. Oh, I think it was there to wake me up, because once I got up and looked out the window, it flew away pretty swiftly. So I think they were like, oh, he's there, he's fine.
Oh, wow.
It's fine, the Arsecast can go ahead.
This is a new thing, alarm helicopters.
Alarm helicopters, right. It's an app, is it?
And it is an alarm, yeah.
You ordered it for me to make sure I'd be here on time.
Yeah, alarm,
so
alarm choppers, that's what it's called. You can download it from Google Play and the iOS store. And you can get a helicopter to wake you up. I mean, you can get all kinds of things if you want. You can have a jumbo jet.
Great.
Yeah, a glider. Glider's not great, though, because guys just got to sort of swoop by and go, wake up! A bit like that. You've got to be really on the ball.
Sure. That's a high-risk job as
sure
well.
Sure is. Sure, especially in London.
High-risk, low reward.
Yeah. Splat into the side of a building.
Skyscraper, yeah.
So there we are. So look, there isn't a great deal going on. We had a comment on Arseblog News the other day. I hope he doesn't mind me reading this out. I'm going to find the story here. And it was from one of the guys called Monkey Joe. He says, is there a tech glitch or are you closing down? There's no news articles for 2 days. I was like, well, there's been no news. There's been literally nothing going on from an Arsenal point of view. So on that, thank you very much to David Ornstein for giving us at least a small snippet of something to talk about. Dr. Gary O'Driscoll, who was rumoured, believed to be leaving the club for Liverpool, is set to stay.
Well, if there was ever a time we needed a doctor.
Yeah, I was just going to say, the optics of losing your doctor right now.
I think that, you know, when this broke out, they obviously made him an offer he couldn't refuse. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Doubled his money. Please, God, we need the doctor.
Also, think about how it would look, you know, from a professional point of view. You abandon your people at a time when we need you the most.
I mean, he you know... He had one foot out the door. Certainly, Arsenal put the job advert up, didn't they?
That's right, yeah.
Replacement. So, yes, as far as, you know, the communication from the club at the time was that he was effectively serving out a notice period or at least waiting until Arsenal secured a replacement to go. Clearly, since then, there's been a bit of a change of heart. So, yeah, look, I mean, I guess that's good news. It's one less thing for us to be worried about, certainly. And... yeah, I imagine they'll be keeping him busy potentially over the next few weeks.
Yeah, no doubt. That didn't last. That discussion didn't last as long as I thought it might.
Thanks, David Ornstein, for that story. This is the end of the podcast now. I mean, no, have you been following... I tell you what, have you been seeing what the players are up to on Instagram? Because that's what I've been doing mainly.
I mean, I'm sure I've watched Instagram, but I haven't really been paying... too much attention. Tell me, who is doing what? Who's the most interesting player to follow on Instagram if we need some distraction in these times
Interesting is stretching it.
Okay.
Basically, they're all doing what they're told. So the club have got them all doing personalised exercise routines. And I spoke to someone who said that they're getting equipment out to the players. If they don't have a home gym, many of them have got home gyms, but if they don't, they've got to supply them with, you know, a treadmill or whatever other equipment they might need, which apparently, as you can imagine, is a bit of a logistical nightmare in the current circumstances.
Wow, somebody, you know, who supplies treadmills is you know, has got a business opportunity going there.
Yeah, but the thing is, I guess Arsenal probably aren't the only club looking to do that. So there might be a shortage on, never mind masks and hand sanitizer, I think running machines might be next. But so yeah, they're all at home. I mean, I don't know, did you see the video of Sead Kolasinac training in his gym at home?
No.
He's got an 8-foot statue of Batman in it.
Get out of here. Really?
He honestly does, yeah.
Is this on his Instagram?
I'm not sure. I think it's on Arsenal's Twitter feed. Hang on.
Let's see here.
Maybe it's not. Maybe just put Kolasinac into Twitter. I mean, it's an
I do see it. I see, yeah.
Have you found it?
I have found it. Wow.
He's legitimately got... I mean, no wonder he was so good at taking on, you know, baddies and criminals. He's Batman's his idol.
inspired by Bruce Wayne. That's maybe a gigantic Batman. Where do you get one of those?
I don't know. Do you think Mesut Ozil bought it for him after the whole...
Seems like that would be a nice
incident.
Present. Yeah.
That he was like, you're my hero. Here's an 8-foot statue of Batman. And Sead thought, I'm going to put that in my gym as a kind of model for me to emulate.
I mean, to be fair, Kolasinac and Ozil as Batman and Robin is not a bad shout, is it?
No, that is... I mean, that would work, I think. Batman and Robin, yeah.
Like the old school Batman and Robin, not like...
Yeah, yeah. So you get Robin in red with, you know, yellow sleeves.
Little kind of weedy Robin.
Yeah, and a little eye mask. I can imagine Ursel, you know, that would work for him. And, yeah, big old Batman, sad. So he's been doing that. They've all been playing computer games, really. I mean, that's what footballers do. They're playing Fortnite or FIFA, as far as I can tell.
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, I think it's... Yeah, it's the club are in uncharted territory here, like all of us, and they're trying to figure out, you know, how this can work. When can they open Colney again, which has been deep cleaned? I mean, obviously the players are still in isolation for another week or so. So it's it's super weird for them, I imagine.
Yeah, we will have to do a FIFA live stream. So you're going to have to get FIFA 20 for your PlayStation.
Well, I have to leave the house today for another purpose, and but I will try and pick up FIFA.
You can also download it.
I know you can, but I think that my hard drive might start to creak at that point.
Okay.
So I'm going to see if I can get a real hard copy. If that's not a good enough excuse to leave the house, what is, frankly?
Exactly. So we will do that at some point, you know, maybe this week, depending how quickly things get sorted and we can display to the world again our astonishing powers and skills on FIFA. I'm looking forward to taking you on again. I think I won the last time, didn't I? We played best of three, and I won 2-1.
Yeah, that feels likely. Yeah. But I think you also had a lot of people sent off.
I did. I just can't stop the temptation to slide tackle someone when the ball is gone.
Sure.
And I know that's not the right way to play the game, not the best way to play the game, particularly when you play online and you're playing against people who are quite good and you're down to 10 men, then 9 men and stuff. It's just so satisfying.
Does the game get abandoned at a certain point?
Yeah, you do. If you get 5 players sent off, I think the game is abandoned, or maybe 6. Mm. I don't know. I have done that a few times where you've had 3 players sent off and you go, right, well, that's it. I'm not going to play any more football. I'm literally just going to try and get as many yellow cards and red cards as I can. So I have achieved that at least 10 times in my life.
Right. And I guess the advantage is, you know, you don't suffer the humiliating defeat.
It's only a 3-0. It's only a 3-0. Exactly. It's awarded as a 3-0 win to the opposition.
Perfect.
So, yeah.
Play for that from the beginning, in a way. That's what I might do.
Okay, well, we'll see. We'll see what the story is. But when you get that sorted, we can sort it out, and hopefully we can get it set up right first time. You have to go in and make a party or something. Isn't that right? Because last time, nobody could hear you at first.
Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. We'll figure it out. We'll Google it.
Yeah, we'll Google it. Or no doubt, all of the people watching who know exactly what we're doing wrong will tell us.
Which
is what seemed to happen last time. Here's a little bit of a scoop for you in terms of our kit for next season, assuming that there is a next season. I'm hearing the word burgundy.
Ooh.
Mm. And I'm also hearing the words orange and pink as an away kit or a third kit or something like that. So if you were to Google a dino rod van, I'm guessing that's kind of what we're going to look like.
And this is for next season. So we imagine we'll be wearing this in about 2026, something like that.
When we all come out of lockdown, for sure.
Okay. I mean, the burgundy is interesting. Are we talking like 2006, last season at Highbury sort of burgundy?
Maybe so. Perhaps a bit more red in it than that one. But
I believe that was officially termed red currant, but I don't recall.
Red currant, yes, that's right. That rings a bell.
Yeah.
That definitely rings a bell.
actually a kit that, you know, I think has aged quite well, that 2006 kit. You know, I sort of, 2006? Yeah, 2005, 2006. Like, you know, it was weird at the time, but as a one-off, it's quite cool, I think.
Yeah, I mean, there was the whole thing about the sleeves, wasn't there? You know, no white sleeves and what have you. But, you know, the association of that kit, obviously, with the Champions League run and everything else.
Yeah. What player do you think of when you think of that kit?
Bergkamp.
Same.
I think it's Bergkamp. To do with the goal he scored. The Dennis Bergkamp Day goal. Was it against Wolves?
I think it was West Brom.
Right. That's not bad.
And I think it was his final Arsenal goal, I believe. And I think he actually came on. I think he didn't start on Bergkamp Day. And I think he came on and curled home a lovely, typical Bergkamp goal from the edge of the box. I was there that day. And, it was great. Yeah. But, yeah, I think because it was his final season and all those sorts of things, I also immediately think of him. Despite the Champions League run, despite getting to the final, I suppose in the final we played in the yellow kit, didn't we?
We did. That was the kit that I wore on the train back to Barcelona in a carriage full of Barcelona fans who were quite happily singing songs about, you know, winning things and pointing at me from time to time. And I would just...
Were you wearing it in a sort of show of defiance?
I was like, fuck you.
You were proud.
I was proud. Yeah, I was proud. Yeah. You know, I was proud of what we did and how we got there and, you know, proud of what we did on the night. I mean, I'll always remember the away end, the Arsenal end, sort of standing and singing, you know, at the end of the game. Amazing. But going back, I mean, it was a strange kind of a journey because I was living in Barcelona at the time and... I got the train from Barcelona to Paris, but it was one of those really odd overnight trains. So I got a train maybe from Barcelona to Perpignan, I think, in the south of France. And then loads of people, of course, loads of Barcelona fans as well. We all got on this train, but I had a cabin. It was like a small cabin, but there were four people in the cabin.
I can't imagine you enjoyed that.
No, I didn't really, but it was quite odd because one of them was just this dude who was traveling around Europe. He was just a young guy traveling around Europe. The other two bunks, so there were two bunks, two on each side, and I was on the top bunk on the right and the dude was underneath me, and then the other side was a man and a woman, a sort of, I guess they were in their 60s, but they were Tottenham fans. Because they obviously saw all the football stuff when we got talking about football, but they were Tottenham fans. They were, again, just traveling around. And it was quite odd to be on a train to France with a pair of elderly Tottenham fans.
Yeah,
but,
of course.
Yeah, but then the journey back home was, pure defiance. And it was, I think the iPod had not long been invented at that point. Sure. So I was able to block out most of their stuff and look out the window as the train zoomed from France again. I think I had to go to Perpignan, get a train down from Perpignan into Barcelona. I remember the taxi driver taking me home that night being very nice. He was very nice. He was a Barcelona fan, obviously. But he wasn't one of the real pain in the arse Barcelona fans. Like some of the guys I played football with who were annoying.
Barcelona fans, I think, well, you know, it's slightly that same thing of like Liverpool fans. You know, they think their club's very special, right?
Yeah. Do you remember when we were outside the Kitty O'Shea's where we were playing football and whatever? Do you remember the kid walking past in a Barcelona shirt with Henri 14 on the back of it?
Yeah, I do, actually. What a little twat. I know. And he was 12 months out as well.
Yeah, you were wrong, little fucker.
You were wrong by a whole 1 year, you idiot.
Yeah,
what did he know, that kid? He was, you know, he was onto something there. Yeah, that was outrageous on his behalf.
Yeah. The provocation. I mean, we would have been well within our rights to give him a good shooing, wouldn't we?
Yeah. But of course, we didn't.
No, I mean...
That's what we... Yeah. We swore that day we'd never say what happened.
Exactly. We definitely didn't. We didn't.
He's fine. He's fine.
Yeah, for sure. No violence was carried out on that child.
That kid probably grew up to be like some footballer now who keeps coming back to haunt us.
Dennis Suarez.
I mean? Yeah.
He grew up to be Dennis Suarez. If only we had taken him out at the time, we could have done ourselves a favour.
Dennis Suarez spoke out, didn't he, on the whole coronavirus thing? Did you see that?
Did he?
Quote doing the round?
No.
Well, it was quite early on in it. He put out a statement on Instagram or Twitter, I forget, saying, you know, we play football for the fans. Football without the fans isn't the fans. And it was like, Dennis Suarez speaks out on prospect of games behind closed doors. I mean, pretty much everything he did for Arsenal was behind closed doors. So
yeah, sitting on his arse behind closed doors, being injured behind closed doors, not playing behind closed doors.
He is an expert on the matter. Just trying to think, really, if there's anything else happening in the world.
I don't think there is.
Not Arsenal related, anyway.
Certainly not Arsenal related.
One Arsenal player played.
What?
Mohamed Elneny is the last man standing. He played last night in Turkey. The Turkish league continues. And I believe he is the only first team Arsenal player.
Behind closed doors, or they got fans, or what?
I think they've got fans. Because Turkey's got a very limited sort of a situation, I believe, with coronavirus at the moment. I think we're talking really, really low amount of cases. He played 90 minutes in a 0-0 draw. So there you go.
Wow.
Maybe the most boring Arsenal player to watch is the only one still playing.
I don't know what to say to that.
In the nicest possible
way. Yeah, I don't know what to say to that.
I do forget that Mohamed Elneny plays for us. I'll be honest. It's, you know, it's one of those out of sight, out of mind slightly with him, you know?
It is, and it's one of those where you think, you know, in normal circumstances, next season he won't be playing with us. But I do wonder, you know, what's going to happen when things get back to relative normality, you know, Will there be a transfer market or?
I'm sure there'll be a significant impact on one. You know, the financial implications of all this are huge, and you know, it's as basic as the leagues aren't currently fulfilling their TV contracts. Therefore, they stand to lose quite a lot of money potentially. Add in the revenue that they might lose from not having these games in front of people or at all. And clubs are taking a massive, massive hit. So, yeah, I think if and when there is a transfer market, it will be low-key at best.
Right. I think we've done as much possible Arsenal news or Arsenal related chat as we can do. So is it time?
It is time, I think.
Is it time?
It is time.
What time is it?
It's Magpie Facts time.
Check this out.
Magpie Facts. Yeah, we're coming back. 2020. Sing it, Maggie. That was good for a bird. Well, I tried to tell you so.
Yes, I do.
That they look just like a crow. Magpies are back on patrol. Cause baby, now I got the flow. Cause the football is all off. Please isolate if you got a cough. But we will pick up the slack. Cause Magpie Facts are back.
You lied to me.
When you said that Magpie Facts was dead.
You lied to me.
Yes, I cried. Yes, I cried.
You lied to me.
Please, please bring back Magpie Facts, you said.
You lied to me.
So we did. Return of the
Magpie Facts.
Return of the
Magpie Facts.
Return of the
Magpie Facts.
You know that they are back.
Magpie Facts.
Wow. Magpie Facts are they're back in a big way.
Magpie Facts are back in a big way. You know, there's always a silver lining. For every negative thing, a positive thing can come. And the positive thing has arrived, and then we've opened it, and loads of magpies have flown out and pecked out our eyes.
Okay, so look, I mean, I'm excited for this, because not only was there an amazing audio experience to bring back the magpie facts,
sure.
I'm really excited for the facts themselves. So, you know,
yeah.
don't spare any of the good stuff, James. Just lay it on me straight away.
Well, the good news is, obviously, since we stopped doing magpie facts, loads more magpie... The magpies have been busy. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
They're, like, stuff's coming out about magpies all the time. Because I think us doing magpie facts, that's sort of spiked global interest in magpies. And therefore, there's been a lot of interesting news happening. By the way, how are the magpies that were in your garden? What's going on with them?
Fuck, I don't know. Actually, I do know, because the other morning, one of them was kind of swooping over Lana. I let her out in the morning, and it was sort of just kind of moving like a really crap bird. But deliberately, right. It was sort of just going, look at me, look at me. And she's going fucking berserk out there, barking her head off at it. So they're out there, they're in the tree at the back, the dogs still hate them, and the magpies are definitely taunting the dogs. So,
okay, good to know they're still out there being evil. Well, this is actually, Magpie Facts this week is a beautiful story, because I thought in these trying times, we need something heartwarming and something uplifting, right?
Right, of course.
So, it's set against quite a serious backdrop. So, again, it kind of fits with, you know, the current climate. In 1942, okay, we're going back in time here.
Okay, I've got it.
2 months after the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, President Roosevelt issued Executive Order 9066, which authorized the detention of anyone who was deemed a potential threat to the country, right?
Right.
So, like 120,000 people of Japanese descent living in America were all forcibly relocated into these internment camps. I mean, you know, not nice, right?
Ghastly.
But this guy, Shig Yabu, he's 87 now, and he was one of the guys who lived in those camps.
Hang on, he's 87 now?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, so he would have been very small then, yeah, of course.
He was very small then, 1942. But the only way that he survived that camp and sort of, you know, got himself through that experience was by befriending a magpie, right?
I thought you were going to say eating magpies.
No, this is what Shig says. He says, this little baby bird was begging for food, and an older bird said to me, that bird's going to die. So Shig rescued the magpie and named it Maggie. Right. So far, this is a lovely, sweet story. It's sort of like Kez, but set in the 40s with a Japanese kid and a magpie.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So far. Then it starts getting a bit weird. Right. The bird's talent. This is a quote from the newspaper article. The bird's talent for mimicry entertained internees during a dire time. Every time I left or returned, I would say, hello, Maggie. And she repeated, hello, Maggie. And if somebody would laugh, she could imitate the exact laughter, which meant kids, seniors, you name it, all came to see her. So this magpie, right, is some sort of impressionist, okay?
Wow.
Now, I didn't know magpies were doing that, did you?
I didn't know magpies. I know there was like ravens and crows can do that, because there was one near us in the neighborhood quite recently who would make strange like car alarm noises and stuff that he was imitating.
Really?
Yeah, it was just, that's, he would impressive. Sit outside the local chipper and make car alarm noises and weird kind of, you know, the noise of a pedestrian light, sort of beep, 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 it would do that as well.
Okay, well, let's just say that Shig and Maggie were pretty close, right? Because the newspaper article goes on to say, Shig says he made a roomy cage for Maggie. When Maggie was let out of her cage, Shig said the bird showed, quote, human-like qualities.
Wow. Right. What, like what?
She was so compassionate with the internees, he said. I don't think she realised she was a bird.
That is amazing.
And then he finishes by saying, I was so fortunate. Maggie and I would talk for hours. So actually, it's, I mean, I'd love to see that conversation play out. But in seriousness, what a beautiful story of a man befriending a magpie. Not all, it seems we've learned in this edition of Magpie Facts, not all magpies are evil.
Wow. I'm just trying to imagine the conversations, if you like.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so the guy says, good morning, Maggie.
And the bird says, good morning, Maggie.
Maggie says, you know, hello?
Yeah, okay.
What do you get from that? Or unless it was speaking to him back in English, that would be something.
Well, that's the implication. The implication is that he and this bird, Maggie, sat there chatting. And also we've learned that Maggie was being very compassionate. How does a magpie show compassion? By not murdering you, I imagine, knowing what they're usually like.
Exactly, by not thrusting itself beak first into your eye.
Listen, so I don't know. In this difficult time for the world, maybe the magpies will offer us some sort of truce.
Maybe they're the way forward. Maybe trying to find a link between us and magpies is how we get out of this.
Yeah.
Maybe. Or maybe.
Maybe. Like, if this was a film, they'd be like, we've solved the crisis. We've solved the coronavirus crisis. What do you mean? And then they cut to, like, a lab, and there's a scientist there with, like, a load of magpies. And he's like, I found the link, and that's fixed it.
That's the end. Fade to black.
Or maybe, you were going to say?
Or maybe they're just like dolphins, and they're lulling us into a full sense of security, and at some point they're going to fuck us.
Listen, I don't want to tread on this guy's relationship, historic relationship with the magpie in the 40s, but I feel like that magpie was kidding him on. Do you know what I mean? Knowing what they're like, I think that magpie was playing some sort of long game.
Well, you know what, though? I mean, he's 87 now, so the magpie didn't take him out.
Maybe.
Well, no, definitely.
Is he working
still alive
for the magpies?
Double agent.
He could be a double agent.
Fucking hell.
We know the government suspected him. That's why they put him in the internment camp.
There's no
what
end.
They suspect him of?
No end
working
to their
for the
cunning
magpies all along.
Oh, God damn it. God damn it. Well, look, there is a magpie fact and a half.
I mean, it blew my mind. And the good news is, you won't believe this, Andrew, but lots of people have been getting in touch with me to let me know little magpie facts that they've picked up over the past 6 months or so. So
okay,
we
got
can
more
really
to come.
Keep this. There's plenty more where that came from.
All
let me tell
right.
You.
Well, I think, you know, given how triumphant the return of magpie facts was, we should go out with a bit more magpie music at the end
yes,
of
please.
Part one. All right.
I'm excited for this.
You should be. And I do have to give a shout out to Jamie West, who's on Twitter at Jamie Edward, who sent us this concept in a series of tweets. So thank you very much indeed, Jamie. And we have turned your tweets into this.
Squawking and pooing on your clothes, avian criminal. Bruises on both your knees, cause I flew down and pecked you in the eye. Diss me on podcasts, all you like my threats, subliminal. So you're a tough guy, feathers all puffed up guy, stick it up your chaff guy, Arsenal talking bluff guy. I'm a bad type, swoop and kill your dead type, give your girlfriend big fright, attack your mama mid-flight. I'm a magpie.
Duh.
Welcome back to the Arsecast Extra. This is part two of the show where we answer questions that you send to us on Twitter at Gunnarblog and at Arseblog on the Arseblog Facebook page, facebook.com/TheArseblog. And also on the Arseblog Discord chat server, which you get access to if you are an Arseblog member on Patreon. So we do have some questions. I think, you know, it would be fair to say that, you know, while we are taking everything seriously and we're not trying to downplay everything, we are trying to just find a little light relief in certain things. So if certain questions reference coronavirus, you know, we're not trying to be insensitive in any way, which is why I'll start with this one. I did quite like this one because it's a... a variation on a theme. It comes from Decaf Metcalf's analytical calf, who's at the Merhaf on Twitter. He says, would you rather fight one Terrera-sized coronavirus or a million Corona-sized Terreras? Which I like.
That's very funny, yeah. And I don't know, of course.
I don't know the answer. So this one as well, from Bo, who's at Bo Buckland. Which member of the current Arsenal squad would you least like to spend a two-week quarantine with?
Ooh, least like.
I mean, if you went around Mesut Ozil's, you've got Fortnite, you've got video games.
That's fine. I'm happy with that. I'm going to say I'd least like to spend it with David Luiz, because every time I tried to get sleep, he'd do that annoying thing to my face.
Oh, yeah.
I couldn't cope with that.
Oh, that would be really annoying, wouldn't it?
That's the last thing you want in quarantine, someone who's constantly doing practical jokes on you.
And touching your face with their filthy hands.
As well.
Get your hands off me.
He must be stopped. What about you?
I'm just trying to look at the squad. I think probably Guendouzi.
Right. Yeah.
I think so.
You just think he'd get sort of aggy?
I think he'd be annoying, you know? I've seen some of the videos where he's a young guy, and I'm not sure his particular brand of young guy humor would tally with mine.
Yeah, what was the... Did you see the quote from Kolasinac about Guendouzi? Which was very...
Oh, funny. It was one of those teammates things, like who's the most...
This is it. He's young. This is Kolasinac on Guendouzi.
Right.
He's young. He likes to do jokes. Every morning he's laughing. So for me, Matteo, he does a lot of bad things. I am not telling this for television. And then he does eventually give an example, which is, if I'm playing cards and I lose, he sometimes comes behind me and shouts, ah, you lost! Things like this.
Wow. Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking as well.
Yeah. That sounds exactly like the sort of thing you'd be worried about.
Yeah. Yeah. No thanks. Yeah. So there we go. Thankfully, we don't. They're quarantining or quarantining. They're in isolation.
They're on their own.
They're on their own.
What about this from Met, who's at AFC Met? It is Theo Walcott's birthday today, and so it is 16th of March. How old do you think Theo Walcott is today, Andrew?
23. No, I'm gonna guess.
That's actually correct.
31.
He is 31.
Wow.
Years old.
Okay. Well, that's not bad. Yeah.
Quite weird, isn't it, that he's over 30? Will always be weird to me.
Yeah.
But what is your favourite Theo Walcott memory? Was the question.
Good question. I think it has to be him playing really, really, really badly in the first 45 minutes. Of a game against Tottenham and then scoring twice in the second half as we won one of those games 5-2.
I think it's the first 5-2.
I remember, you know, at the time going, wow, I can't believe he's actually back out for the second half because he was terrible. And is that the game in which one of the goals he's put through, and I think he takes a heavy touch, and his finish is brilliant. He just clips it over the goalkeeper, but he only makes that finish because his first touch was really bad. So I think that would be one of them. But I do remember a goal that he scored in a European away game where he set free down the left-hand
side.
And he just sort of... Like you're looking at, he took it really early. He took the shot so early, and I was thinking, why don't you take it in a bit? But he just sort of passed it around the goalkeeper.
Shakhtar Donetsk.
Is that what it was? Let me have a look here. Is it on the YouTube?
It's on the YouTube. Wilshere just pokes it over the top. He starts about 10 yards in his own half, and he just tears away. It is a brilliant, brilliantly taken goal.
Okay, here it is. I'm just going to watch it here. So it might play. The audio might play.
From Walcott. Here's Wilshere. And Walcott, the furthest player.
Here he goes.
And he's burnt them up for pace to get clear here. Theo Walcott! Goal!
25 yards out when he
finishes. Yeah, he's just... I mean, okay, goalkeeper's a bit slow, but I like that goal. I do like that goal.
I like that goal. I've got a couple. So... I don't know if you remember Walcott's performance when Arsenal played Newcastle in December 2012. It was in right in the midst of the will he, won't he sign a new contract thing. And we played Newcastle and we won 7-3, I think.
7-3.
And Walcott scored a hat-trick and set up two goals. And presumably this was the game that sort of persuaded them to give him all the money. A decision that didn't necessarily pay dividends, but... it was a sensational performance, and I think his third hat-trick goal was the one where he sort of has the ball on the left-hand side, seems to get fouled, falls on the floor, jumps
up. He is fouled, 100%. I think everyone stopped for a penalty, didn't they?
Right, yeah. He jumps up, skips inside a couple of people, and then lifts it over the goalkeeper. It's just a great goal. Mm. And I think like in that moment I was like, oh, maybe he's going to be like Thierry Henry was sort of like, you know, the shorthand that we were all thinking. Mm. But my absolute actual favourite Walcott moment, just because it was in the moment, it was so exhilarating and so exciting, was his assist for Adebayor in that Champions League match against Liverpool. Mm. I know we didn't win, but in that moment, I just thought, wow, that's special what he did then. And, you know, he was only a teenager at that time.
Yeah, that's right. That was in that white kit, wasn't it?
The white kit. It was quite an extraordinary assist. And I thought, we've got something really special here. And the thing is...
Didn't Adebayor run off and celebrate that goal like he'd scored it all himself?
Of course he did.
Did he even say thanks to Walcott? Yeah, sorry.
I think he realised that everyone else had run to Walcott. And then he was like, oh yeah, better do that. Mm. But... an interesting career there, Walcott, isn't it? Especially in his time at Arsenal. I mean, you know, it felt like he was often quite highly criticised, but he did also score
a lot of goals.
Mm.
He did score a lot of goals. Yeah,
I think
at least
he did score 100 goals.
Yeah, he was over 100 goals. Theo Walcott goals.
This age of sort of asking for more end product from people, I mean, that he largely did have end product. It was kind of everything else that was problematic.
Yeah. I don't know how many goals he scored. Let's see. Stats by club. 108 in total.
74 in the Premier League.
So there you go. That's a lot of goals. Very decent. I think we need to give an honourable mention to the goal against Chelsea as well.
Another one where he fell down.
Down and everyone stopped and he just got back up and smashed it in beyond Petr Cech, if I remember. So
Yeah.
So
some really great moments. There was a goal as well. I think it was on the final day of the season before the Aston Villa Cup final where he absolutely smashed it into the top corner from a very wide angle. Do you remember that? And it was the goal that got him the start in the FA Cup final over Giroud.
That's right. Who were we playing? Was it Burnley or somebody like that?
Someone like that on the final day.
And he hadn't played for ages and ages.
Yeah, but it was like he was so good.
West Brom. He scored a hat-trick.
He scored a hat-trick.
Against West Brom.
Right, you are. Oh, yeah, this is it. And one of the goals, I'm just watching a video of it on Facebook now. He just hit it from an absurd angle very early, and it sort of went in off the far... sort of, it went off the bar, in fact. Yeah. Funny player. Strange player. Yep. Could be brilliant. Could be not brilliant.
Yes. Truer words have not been spoken.
In summary, there you go.
There you go. Okay, here's a question from the Discord. Well, here's one from Neil Siglechner, who says, I can't shake the feeling that this is all somehow Ivan Gazidis' fault. What do you think? Yes, it must be. But Anne Berg, 28, says, Kolasinac seems to have a full-size Batman in his home gym, which we discussed earlier.
He does.
If you could put three superheroes in our starting 11, who would they be? And where would you play them?
Three superheroes in the starting 11?
Yeah.
Right. I think I'd put Flash on the wings.
Need that pace, in fairness.
Need that pace, right? We need to replace that Theo Walcott-style player. I'm trying to think now. I mean, the thing is, Superman, he's going to be good, isn't he?
I mean, he's super. Pretty much everything.
Everything he does is going to be great.
Do you remember like when he was a baby Superman or a little Superman lad, and in one of the films he's taking a field goal in an American football or whatever it is, and he just boots it and it goes, I think the ball is probably still circumnavigating the globe. It's like a satellite. So he could really take a good free kick, Superman. It seems a bit obvious though, doesn't it?
I guess. I mean, I was thinking Hulk as a DM.
Do you know what I mean? Didn't he play for Brazil though?
Yeah, true. And he was more of an attacker with them.
Yeah.
I guess you've got to have Hulk. We know he's good at football. He's a Brazil international, right?
Right. Okay.
I think Spider-Man in goal, because he could sort of do the web stuff, you know? Like he could create a big web in the goal that stops stuff going in.
I'm not sure that that's necessarily legal.
And having superheroes in the team is fine.
Well, look, if we can have them, I presume other people can have them.
Okay. Well, so, maybe that's not legal. But I still think he's very dexterous, isn't he? He's very agile.
Okay. So you're going Spider-Man, Superman.
Spider-Man in goal. Hulk DM.
Hulk DM.
Flash on the wings. I'm not picking Superman. It's too obvious.
All right. I am going to pick... So I'm going to have to pick different ones. For my goalkeeper, I'm going to have the guy, the stretchy guy from the Fantastic Four.
Yeah. I don't know what he's called either. Let me have a look now while you think of your next one.
I think he, you know, obviously would be good in goal. So, stretchy dude, whatever his name is. Mr. Stretch.
His name is Mr. Fantastic.
Right. That's, you know, that really doesn't give you a...
That's a lame
doesn't
name.
Give and you fact, a clue as to his powers, does it? Like,
what's
you know,
quite funny is when you go to type it into Google, you type Fantastic Four, and one of the sort of prompted searches is Stretchy Guy.
Oh, really?
Because nobody knows what he's called.
The color, yeah, Mr. Fantastic. Isn't that a Shaggy song? No. Anyway,
Mr. Boombastic.
Okay, so I've got Stretchy Guy, Mr. Fantastic in goal. I also am going to choose a DM.
Yeah,
Wolverine.
Nice.
Yeah, so try get past him when you've got fucking four spikes in your gut.
Hang on, so I'm not allowed the webs, but you're allowed the metal claws for stabbing people?
This is on our team. You know, it's fine. It's the opposition that are going to get eviscerated, James. Don't worry about it.
Okay, all right, okay.
And I think up front, I'm going to have Catwoman. Played by Michelle Pfeiffer.
Okay. And what's the logic there?
I would just like to watch Catwoman.
Fair enough. Yeah, so, yeah. No one's going to argue with that.
Yeah, exactly. You know, you can all pick your own teams. She's got good whip on her crosses, in fairness. You know, so.
Very nice. Very nice. So, what about this one? This is from Fletcher Finn on the Facebook. We've extended the olive branch to Facebook. Since there is no football to watch, tell me about it, Fletch. What two Arsenal games, very specific, should I watch that took place in the past 10 years? And I've watched the full 90 minutes back. You can have one choice each. Oh, I see. That's what they've done.
Oh, so what, we can
past
only
10
choose?
Years.
Wow.
What, I don't know why they've set that parameter on it, because, I mean... Well, I know what my answer is, probably.
I mean, are you going to choose, like, the cup final or something like that?
Yeah,
the probably. 2014 one?
I was going to choose that, but then you'd have got a first half, which is genuinely quite painful to observe and stressful.
Yeah, but the pain actually gives you the payoff at the end, you know?
That is true, but... I'm going to make a case for the 2015 Cup final because it was just fun. Like, we just bossed it start to finish.
That's right.
We were just comprehensively better than Tim Sherwood's Aston Villa.
Speaking of Tim Sherwood's Aston Villa, should we put that clip in?
Oh, yeah.
Let's put the clip in from one of the Arsecast extras in the past where we were asked, or you asked me, I think, what did Tim Sherwood say to his players in the dressing room. Let's play this.
I mean, I don't know how well the hell we're going to find it, but if we can...
I'll find it. Don't worry.
Okay. This one is from Fax Siraj. Like that name, straight away.
Have you forgotten that we just did a question by Fax Siraj? Has he got another question?
Has he got another question? Yeah, we have. Yeah.
Wow.
Wow. Big day if you're Fax Siraj.
Not only are you named after one of the top 11 ways of sending information in an electronic format.
Yeah.
You've got two questions. I think this is unprecedented. Unprecedented.
Has this ever happened before? Wow. I mean, screw the FA Cup. This is the real prize. So, Fax Siraj asks, because I don't know if you know this, but this is what happened. He says, what do you think Tim Sherwood was doing locked in the changing room with his team after the final?
I would say Tim Sherwood sat them all down and took his cock out.
Okay. Is that the end of it, or...?
No.
I think it should be.
No.
All right.
He said to them, I want you to look at this. Look at it. Benteke, get your eyes off the floor, you fucker. Look at this. If you don't want to see this every fucking week, then you better fucking play better than you did today. The ones of you that are going to be let... Grealish, eyes on the cock right now.
Please, sir, no.
The ones of you that are going to be here next season, and that's not many of you, because I'm going to sell you all. I'm going to bring you down to a fucking Sunday car boot sale and flog you all off. But if you're here next season and you don't want to see this mighty thing in your faces, sure. You play better than that. Because this is nothing, not my fault that you lost the FA Cup final. I'm certainly not tactically inept. My answer to being fucking 2-0 down in an FA Cup final, or 3-0 down in an FA Cup final, I brought on Gabriel Agbonlahor. So who's the fucking assholes here? Look at the cock! That's what I think he said. I'm just speculating.
Allegedly.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad Fax Siraj got on twice. I think it was worth it.
Yeah, I think it was.
So, yeah, I'm going to make the case for that. It's just a relaxed watch of Arsenal dominating a cup final.
Okay.
What about you? I've left 2014 there for
you. I don't know if it was in the last 10 years. It may not be, actually, because it probably happened outside of that. There was a game we played against Bolton.
Right.
Away from home.
Away from home. Okay.
And I think we went down to 10 men.
2-0. Yes, Diaby was sent off.
For a pretty bad tackle, actually, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, I looked this up recently because it's one of my favourite Arsenal games too. Is it within the 10 years? 2008. I think it's still worth talking about. So we went 2-0 down to Bolton and Matty Taylor scored both goals. This was in the time of Gary Megson's glorious Bolton reign. And Arsenal lost Diaby after half an hour.
Right.
And then they somehow came back. They scored their first goal on the 62nd minute and they came back to win the game 3-2.
And the final goal was scored by Cesc, if I'm right.
It was actually... classed as a J. Lloyd Samuel
own goal.
I can't remember. Fabregas's shot was turned in by Samuel. So I guess it wasn't going in. The other goals were Gallas and Van Persie.
Oh, fuck. That's kind of ruined it a bit.
That's taken the edge off.
Yeah, it's taken a... But yeah, that's a good one. What else would I like to watch again? I mean, the wins over... Spurs. I'd like to watch. Yeah, this is an Arsenal game. I wouldn't mind watching that one where Newcastle beat Spurs about 5-0 on the final day of the season.
Oh, yeah, that'd be funny.
That was good.
I mean, the 7-3 over Newcastle is quite good fun, genuinely, that we were talking about earlier. Arsenal Barcelona, that falls within the first leg. 2-1.
You see, I don't know if. I mean,. Maybe we have rose-tinted memories of that game, but I kind of feel like it was a bit... I mean, maybe the fact that it was so nerve-wracking because they had so much of the ball and every time they got near our box, it was like, uh-oh. You know, I'm not sure it was that enjoyable until we scored, but maybe that's just part of it, is it?
Yeah, it was stressful. It was a stressful game, that's for sure.
Yeah. What was our team that night?
What, the Barcelona night?
Yeah. I'm just looking.
Giroud played, didn't he?
Giroud played, yeah, that's right. Chesney, Koscielny, Giroud, Clichy, Eboué, Fabregas, Nasri, Walcott, Bentner was on, Alex Song, Wilshere and Van Persie. Our subs on the night were Almunia, Skrilacci, Gibbs, Rosicki, Danielson. Danielson, wow. Arshavin and Bentner. Arshavin obviously came off the bench to score the goal, to lift up a shirt with his own face on it, which is still one of my favourite things that a footballer has ever done. Like, whatever about Ian Wright wearing the, you know, the t-shirt to break the just goal scoring it. Record. Yeah, the just done it t-shirt. And I remember him saying recently on a thing, he was wearing it for about four or five games. But like a t-shirt with your own face on it, and you lift up your shirt to display your own face.
The only way it could have been better is if the picture had been of him wearing the t-shirt with his own face on it. And it was just kind of an infinite thing of Arshavin.
Arshception. It's difficult to say.
Arshception.
That is difficult to say.
But there's some ideas for people if they want to go back.
Yeah, there's loads. We'll probably do some rewatches of games and stuff as well to give us something to talk about on the podcast. Asborn Carlsbeck, who's at CarlsBK, says, what happened to the robot voice? Look, we just brought back Magpie Facts. We need to spread out the good stuff. We don't want to use it all up too early. Yeah.
We've got to spread this out. We could be here for months.
Yeah. So,
but good to know. Good to know we've got that in the closet.
Yeah. We have so many things, like robot voice and... anyway, we'll make it up.
Stuff will happen, all right?
Yeah.
Things
will happen. We've also got on the Discord, Sunny Cool, what's your all-time Arsenal 11? Listen, we need to be 6 months into this thing before we do that one. So, I think
Fast forward 6 months, we are here going, but Seaman or Layman? It will be happening.
Yeah, Seaman.
Is the answer correct?
Abba Saleh, who's at Abba_Saleh, says, be honest, do you miss Sweet Caroline?
I saw that question. I mean, a tiny bit. I don't hate it as much as everybody else. I can imagine you don't miss it at all.
No, I mean, I suppose the implication is, do you miss hearing it when Arsenal win? I miss the Arsenal winning things, but then there hasn't been enough of that this season to really feel it's lost too keenly.
No, I mean, that's an interesting thing. I mean, how much are you missing Arsenal playing? Because, we've been better of late, but it's a weird thing where I think for the first couple of weeks, I'll kind of be all right with it. I'll kind of be like, oh, you know, this has been such a weird season that it's not the worst thing that it's not.
Yeah, your focus is sort of elsewhere, isn't it? Because there are much bigger things and wider things for us to worry about and be concerned about. But, you know, at some point, I think we're going to go stir crazy.
Oh, for sure.
From a footballing point of view. So right now, it's only a few days, really, without Arsenal. But, you know, if we get 2, 3, 4 weeks down the line, I don't know.
We'll see. We'll see what happens. I'm just looking for what other questions I've got. Oh, this is interesting. Piers Moyles, who's at AKA Percy.
Almost. Put the heart crossways in me there.
Is there an Arsenal player who left to join a bigger club who most of the fans hated, but you didn't begrudge them and always liked them? I will say he's put bigger in inverted commas there. E.g., not many fans like the Ox for what he did, but I still have a soft spot for him.
I suppose for me it's Cesc.
Yeah, likewise. Definitely that would be one of the ones that I would think of.
Yeah. I mean, I understand why people might not. But, you know, I just always have a soft spot for Cesc as a player, and always will. And I know, you know, things probably could have been handled better from both ends when that transfer to Barcelona happened. And also, you know, as much as I hated seeing him in Chelsea colours, it's not that I didn't begrudge him that. I mean, he's a footballer. It's his job. What is he supposed to do? You know, we could have brought him back and we didn't. Mm. So, you know, he's got to do his thing. So, you know, I was able to sort of more or less wipe out those however many years he spent there, seeing him in blue. So, yeah, I think Cesc for me. The Ox as well, like I thought, you know, that whole thing on the last day that he played was a shambles. But then I don't think you should play a guy. Like, it's not as if Arsenal didn't know what was happening. You can't play a guy in those circumstances. So, I don't really make any excuses for the Ox in terms of what happened that day. But it was abject overall from an Arsenal point of view. And I think there were bigger issues going on at that time.
Agreed. And, you know, he does seem like a fairly decent guy, so I don't really have anything particularly against him. Mm. Trying to think of anyone else, but I mean, I guess when Gael Clichy left and went to Man City, I didn't ever dislike Gael Clichy as a consequence.
Yeah, but Gael Clichy was one of those players that you're kind of like,
Yeah.
There's Gael Clichy.
And, you know. Kolo Touré fits into that bracket as well, where he went to Man City and I was like, that's fine.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like, I know Man City weren't quite the force then that they are now.
No, but that's true. And Bakary Sagna as well. You know, I didn't really begrudge Sagna his move either, because he got to the end of his contract. And, you know, he gave us a lot of fantastic performances during a very difficult time for the football club. And he was one of the true consistent players that we had at that time. You would always get 7-8 out of 10 from Bakary Sagna, you know. I didn't begrudge him that, particularly as he got to the end of his contract. He's fully entitled to do what he wants to do at the end of it. You know, it wasn't like he was agitating for moves, or, you know, he didn't do, like, for example, Nasri can go fuck himself for all eternity as far as I'm concerned.
Sure.
Kleb, what a dope. You know, I understand why he made the move, but, like, what a disaster that was for his career. And Van Persie, you know, he can sit in a room and listen to Phil Collins forever, as far as I'm concerned.
I agree.
Okay.
I agree. Next one?
Next one. Okay, a couple of food-related ones. We have got one from Benzi, who's at mind_of_Benzi, who says, you're only allowed to have Chinese or Indian takeaway delivered throughout your quarantine. What do you choose?
I would choose Indian, personally. What about you?
Same. Just flavors are better, I think.
Delicious, yeah. Really. I lived three doors down from a very nice curry house, and I've been far too much in the last few months. And in fact, when I went in there last time, the guy who works there said to me, oh, are you James? And I was like, yeah, why? He was like, last time you were here, there was a guy in here, and he says he listens to your podcast every week. And he's telling me that you're famous. And I was like, I'm definitely not famous at all.
But he didn't spot you a Lamb Rogan or anything, no?
No, nothing. Wow. I paid full price. That's ridiculous.
No, I meant the other guy, the guy who thought you were famous.
Oh, right. He was like, next time he brought over like a chicken tikka masala. He's like, compliments of the gentleman there. And he's just there raising a glass. It's a very small curry house. It'd be very weird.
Okay. And Henrik Ho Jacobson says, hi, guys. What's the best sandwich you can make at home? I'm going down to the supermarket in a couple of hours. So he's getting in his sandwich supplies.
What sandwich can you not make at home? That's my question.
Well, that's it. But he said, what's the best? I mean, I suppose, you know, some sandwiches might be elaborate in fancy sandwich shops or whatever, you know.
Mm.
Sourdough, you know, whatever's that, you know, the general person might not have if they're making their own breads and sauces and, you know, whatever's.
I like, I mean, I don't know if this qualifies as fancy or not. I do like a sort of parma ham, mozzarella, rocket, sunblush tomato, that sort of Italian-y type of sandwich, maybe on like ciabatta bread or something like that.
Yeah, that's a very Guardian sandwich, isn't it?
Prawn. I'll just have prawn. I do like that.
Yeah. I think, you know, a good club sandwich is, you know, if you get a good club sandwich, it's a
chicken
really...
Chicken club.
Yeah, chicken club, chicken, bacon, lettuce, tomato, in the, you know, the three layers, cut into the triangles. It's a great sandwich if you can make it happen, you know?
That was what I was going to say before I exposed, you know, my hideous North London privilege.
Mm.
But yeah, chicken club's good. I can't argue with that.
Cheese, ham and cheese toasty as well, though.
You Listen, know? You can't go wrong with it.
How do you it's do delicious. Yours? Do you have a Breville? Do you have a sandwich maker or do you do them in a pan?
I would do mine in a pan at the moment if I was to do them. I don't have a Breville.
No, neither do I.
Yeah, I don't love the Brevilles, actually.
I like the fact that sometimes the cheese drips out.
You and like then, that sort of ooze effect.
Yeah, and then it goes kind of hard. And you get some like really crispy melted or crispy burnt cheese as well. I do like that part.
Right, okay. I don't like what it does to the crusts. Do you know what I mean? Like the way it sort of compresses the sandwich into a shape.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't like that.
Well,
listen,
to each
these
are
the challenges we face in this time.
Exactly, exactly. You know, we all have to come through these trials and tribulations. Are the crusts acceptable or not? These are the major issues that we're dealing with on a day-to-day basis.
I had this question. It's not too cheerful, but I don't think it's too gloomy. Russ Morgan, I guess a lot of people are going to be watching films at the moment, says, what is your favourite apocalyptic film?
Oh,
I think mine is 28 Days Later.
That's a good one, actually, yeah.
But I haven't been tucking into the apocalyptic films. There's nothing on the news.
I'm trying to have a... Let me see. Apocalypse films. So there's probably all kinds of zombie films. The Road, we were talking about that. That is relentlessly grim, isn't it? I Am Legend. Yeah. I love the book, I Am Legend. There's a great book for you if you're... if you're looking for something to read, the movie with Will Smith isn't great, but the book itself is fucking fantastic. Mad Max, those are good.
I liked the new one as well, the recent one.
Fury Road.
Fury Road was a great film.
Yeah.
It looked incredible.
That was good. But I'm going to say Shaun of the Dead.
Yeah, great shout.
Why not?
It's a good film.
It's apocalypse, and it's also kind of funny. So that's what we need.
And how have we got through this without mentioning the masterpiece that is Waterworld? I mean...
I don't think I've ever seen it.
Have you not?
No.
Kevin Costner is a man who's a fish. Oh, it's incredible. I mean, it's the biggest flop of all time, wasn't it, in terms of...
Yeah, I remember. It cost a lot of money, didn't it?
It cost a lot of money. It made not a lot of money. And it's actually... It's quite good fun. It's kind of like Mad Max, but on water. But he's got gills in it. Spoiler alert.
He's got gills, okay.
It's basically Kevin Costner with gills. Check it out. It'll be available somewhere.
Right.
It's nonsense. It's nonsense, but it's like quite fun nonsense, you know.
Okay. Maybe I'll watch that before, you know, at some point over this period of self-isolation.
Right, well, I look forward to your review. I mean...
Dennis Hopper is in it.
Dennis Hopper is the baddie. It's...
Did I ever tell you my Dennis Hopper story?
No, I don't think so.
So this is one of the strangest things that's ever happened to me in my life.
That's a hell of an introduction to a story.
Mid-1990s.
I remember
club that. Culture is at its peak. House music. These big... super clubs in Dublin. There was one called The Pod. People would dress up of a Saturday night. They'd go out. They would chemically enhance their evening.
Of course.
And they would dance. And the music was great. And it was fun times. Really fun times. So one Saturday night in The Pod, having a grand time. And... You know the way back then everybody kind of faced in the one direction when they were dancing? Everyone was sort of faced in one direction up towards the stage or the DJ box or whatever it was. Because the DJ was king back then. The DJ was the coolest guy. So I'm in there having a grand time, dancing away, turn around for some reason, look behind me, and there is Dennis Hopper.
No way.
Absolutely way. With a young woman dancing behind him. And when I tell you that Dennis Hopper was the most mad out of it person in that entire club, I'm not telling you a lie. He was off his tits.
Right.
Dancing away, having a great time. And I was like, what this is very, very surreal. And I turned around again, and yes, there he was. I hadn't imagined it or hallucinated it. That was Dennis Hopper.
Yeah.
In the pod. Sometime in the mid-90s. I don't know where he ended up or what the rest of his night entailed.
Did you ever say, hello, are you Dennis Hopper?
You don't really, you know.
No.
That wouldn't be the thing to do.
Wasn't the time or the place. Thank God there weren't camera phones then.
Yeah. Wow. There were barely phones, actually. Yeah,
barely cameras, even.
So there you go. So there's my Dennis Hopper story.
Well, it's out there now.
I'm
sure that'll turn up in Mail Online tomorrow.
Hopper Dennis in drug Hopper's frenzy.
Drug controversy revealed on football podcast.
He's dead as well, so.
Oh, he's dead.
He is dead. He died in 2010. Fuck.
Christ.
Yeah.
I'd completely forgotten that.
Right. Well, look, I think we'll leave it there, will we? Because
we can't top the Dennis Hopper story.
We can't top Dennis Hopper. All right. Well, look, everyone, thank you as always for listening. Hopefully we've given you something of a lift or a fillip, if you want to call it that.
Alleviated some of the boredom.
Yeah,
and,
exactly. Exactly. And look, we'll do the FIFA thing, and we'll try and do other stuff that will keep you entertained as well for as long as we need to. But for now, we'll leave it there, and we'll catch you on the next one.
Bye-bye.